All right, welcome. I'm Tim Scoggins, Chairman of the Shaftsbury Select Board. I'm calling this meeting to order of the Shaftsbury Select Board on Monday, December 19th, 2016, at 6:31. Does any member of the board have a conflict of interest with anything appearing on the agenda this evening?
No.
No? Announcements. Does anyone have any announcements?
Yes, if you just put your letter in for and nominate a Shaftsbury Ordinary Hero to PO Box 401, Shaftsbury, Vermont, Shaftsbury Historical Society, that'd be great. We're still waiting for more nominations to come in. And that will be held in May.
I'd like to announce again that we have a number of open positions in town government. I went through them in detail last time. I'll go through the list a bit quicker today. I'll mention first, because I failed to last time, that the constables, Paul McGann and Bob Perry, their terms end in March 2017, so those positions will be open, as well as the ones that I mentioned last time, which include town clerk. Yes, Judy Stratton is actually retiring after 35 years. Auditor. We have two openings there. Lisa Lentz's position is coming open, as is Bob Holmes. Bob Holmes is retiring after 11 years of service as auditor, including publishing the town report during that time, something that we've very much appreciated. We have two openings on the select board: the town moderator, delinquent tax collector, lister, grand juror, trustee of public funds, town agent, the constables I mentioned. We have two open positions currently on the Planning Commission, and we have one expiring position and two open positions on the DRB. There's an unfilled alternate position and an unfilled member position. And also there are two school board positions coming up for renewal, or that are expiring in March. I would also remind everyone that subsequent to our planning to take over the Grandview Cemetery and adjust our rates to in the town to what had been charged there, the rates for cemetery services are going up January 1. Those rates are available on the website or by contacting Town Hall. Do we have any public comments tonight?
Yes.
Ed Corey.
I did get a letter to the editor. I made Kenny buy a paper, but I just wanted to present you guys with it all, so that anybody could say they didn't know. And I did submit one to Casey Catherine from the state of Vermont. And I'm just trying to express my views. I know the board might not agree with them, but I still think it's a good idea.
Okay.
And then the only other thing I do have is I did get Judy some advice on getting done. It's the same advice my taper Bernie Nichols gave me on sand finishing ceilings. When you're done, walk away and never look back. That's it.
Thank you, Ed. Any other public comments? All right, next up, approval of minutes. We have minutes that were circulated for second here. Let me close that one. Our regular meeting. Yikes. We had minutes circulated for our regular meeting on December 5th. Is there a motion to approve the minutes?
Motion to approve.
Motion to approve from Ken.
Second.
Second by Art. Any additions or corrections to the minutes?
Yeah, I've got a couple. When the planning board was talking to us towards the end, it's where I questioned whether or not we should split the vote. The paragraph starts out, Mr. Whitman questioned whether or not they would want to split the vote.
Yes. I had the same,
My understanding was is that I thought they were in favor of splitting it, but I...
Yes, I agree. I had made the same comment here. I've made that comment many times.
Yes.
And I was surprised I hadn't made it that time. So what I had suggested as a correction here was after it was stated, Mr. Whitman questioned whether anyone believed that any part should be split off from the whole package for a separate vote. Mr. Sylvan stated that it was important for these to go through because of the confusing state of the current bylaws. And instead of no one spoke of splitting any part of the bylaws off, I suggested this language. The board is considering a separate ballot article that would read something like, if the new zoning bylaws draft of item one is approved by voters, shall the new bylaws be further amended to allow restaurants and retail businesses in the village center to be permitted in the village center zone as permitted use with site plan review rather than only as conditional use.
That's what
you were thinking?
Yes.
Yeah,
As long as it doesn't confuse the voters, I think we've got to do it this way.
Yeah, yeah. And I have mentioned, I copied that language because I mentioned it in an email to the town attorney, and she thought that would be fine that way.
And
so without objection, I'll make that correction.
Okay. And then one other thing. On other business, it said that I made a motion and then I seconded it, which I don't think is quite legal.
Yes.
It's quicker, though.
Yes.
I'm pretty sure that was seconded by Mr. Harrington.
Not you, Harry.
Yeah.
So is this per standard legal destroying documents after 20 years? That's their
standard
operating.
It's just all files, too. Everything we're required to have is downstairs.
Yeah, this is just extra copies at the attorney's office. And yeah, I think 20 years worth is plenty. So we made that motion. Any others?
That's all I found.
I had just one or two typos. I noticed a misspelling here and of the word separate. And then up here, there was a line that said, Mr. Corman asked, was left out, whether the DRB would give standing to a potential landowner.
Okay.
Any other additions or corrections? All in favor of approving the minutes for December 5th as amended, say aye.
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 Abstain.
Mitch is abstaining, so that vote passes 3-0-1. All right. And then we also have minutes for our special meeting on the budget. That was on December 12th. Is there a motion to approve?
Motion to approve.
Motion to approve the minutes for December 12th as circulated from Mitch.
Second.
Seconded by Art. Any additions or corrections? I had just one, this is kind of picky wording where we made the presentation to Walter Merritt. Art Whitman presented a plaque to retiring park superintendent Walt Merritt, honoring his 13 years of service to the Shaftsbury Parks and Community. So, in case somebody didn't know that he was the park superintendent. Any other additions or corrections? All in favor of approving the minutes for December 12th as amended, say aye.
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 Motion carries 4-0-0. Warrants. I have check warrant Number 18, in the amount of $114,972.96. Is there a motion to approve?
Motion to approve.
From Mitch?
Second.
Seconded by Art. Yeah, it's getting really dim in here. We need to get some lights. I can barely. It gets harder to read these things every time.
The lights are coming.
Okay, we've got $3,400 for American Rock Salt, $6,300 to Blue Cross Blue Shield, $4,900 to Bennington County Regional Commission, $10,000 to KAS for the sidewalk project. That must have been our final engineering bill on that.
That was a construction inspection bill.
Okay, yeah.
This is a follow-up bill. That's the last, possibly the last on the engineering end of it.
Okay, there was also a $5,400 from KAS. That would have been the engineering.
That's the engineering part. But.
Right.
And there'll probably be one more inspection bill when they put the lights in.
Okay. Any word on when those are coming yet? $3,200 to Newmount Diesel Performance.
That was work on the trucks.
Okay.
Didn't perform too well, but it's a good company.
$2,800 to Reynolds and Sons.
That's parts.
Truck parts.
Mm-hmm.
$6,600 for TAM. $4,300 for Weaver for the sidewalk project. $58,000 to Weaver for the sidewalk project. $4,400 to Daly's. Those are the major items. Any more discussion on check warrant number 18? All in favor of approval, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Check warrant number 18 in the amount of $114,972.96 is approved 400. Next, I have a retirement warrant number 12 in the amount of $101.01. Is there a motion to approve?
Motion to approve.
From Mitch?
Second.
Seconded by Art. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Ken?
Aye.
So, retirement warrant number 12 in the amount of $101.01 is approved 400. Payroll warrant number 12 in the amount of $19,660.19.
Motion to approve.
Motion to approve from Mitch.
Second.
Seconded by Art. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Payroll warrant number 12 in the amount of $19,660.19 is approved 400. Next, check warrant number 16 in the amount of $70,410, which looks to be community appropriations for FY17.
16, right? 16. FY16. They pay them at the end of the year.
16. We're in 17. We're talking about 18. Got it. Yeah. Motion to approve?
Motion to approve.
From Mitch?
These are...
What was voted on last March, yeah. We pay them at the end of the year.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wait till the end of the year to pay them?
Well, we have no money, so. Because by the time the voters approve it, we have to wait for the new budget year, but we don't collect taxes in November, yep. So after we collect the taxes.
Interesting. Okay. I second.
Ticket. Any discussion? Just by way of reminder, we gave money to Arlington Rescue Squad, Bennington County Conservation District, Bennington Habitat for Humanity, Bennington Coalition for the Homeless, Bennington Free Clinic, Bennington Free Library, Bennington Little League, Bennington Project Independence, Bennington Rescue Squad, Bennington Tutorial Center, Brock Community Action, Center for Restorative Justice, Grandview Cemetery Association, Greenup Vermont, McCullough Library, Perrin Acres, Park McCullough Association, Project Against Violence, Violent Encounters, PAVE, Retired Senior Volunteer Program, Shaftsbury Historical Society, Southwestern Vermont Area Agency on Aging, I believe that is, Sunrise Family Resource Center, Turning Point, Vermont Association for the Blind, V&A Hospice, Vermont Center for Independent Living, and WBTN. And that total was $70,410. Any more discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Check warrant number 16 in the amount of $70,410 is approved 400. And now we have check warrant number 16 in the amount of $29,495.12, which is related to the purchase of the 510 North Road property. Motion to approve?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Seconded by Art.
It's all closed.
We have $20 to Judy Stratton, $17.26 to Mert Snow, $27,548 to Tom Daly. That would be the bulk of the price of the house of the property, and $200 to Wilmington Associates for legal. Any more discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Check warrant number 16 in the amount of $29,495.12 is approved 400. And we do now actually own the 510 North Road property.
Was there a deposit? Did we?
It was $1,000.
We had $1,000 deposit at the time of the contract. Yeah,
that's why.
Okay. Yeah.
Yep. Was it? Was the last warrant 16 too?
Different numbers. I think the check warrant was 18. I think one of the payroll warrants might have been 16.
All down at the end of the table.
Okay. They all have
different.
They have a different,
18, payroll
different count.
12, check warrant 16. When they all come back, I'll look at
them. Okay. All right. Approval of warrants is taken care of. Our treasury report. He told us that our treasurer, Melanie Dexter, might be a little late.
Yeah, she has a concert. She'll be here as soon as it's over.
So we will skip over that for now and move on to discussion of community appropriations. We have with us Forrest Wayan tonight, the director of the Bennington Rescue Squad, who's going to talk about his funding request, which is up quite a bit from the previous year. And it looks like you have some friends here with you.
Ray, what's the protocol here? Sit up there?
If you would, yeah, they'll be able to hear you better.
Thank you all.
Could we get you to, you gentlemen, to introduce yourselves, please?
Certainly. Bill Camardi, Director of Operations. I'm Brian Pete. I'm the Chairman of the Board of Directors.
Great, thank you.
I'm sorry, could you just repeat your name out there?
Brian, last name is P-E-A-T.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you guys for letting us come chat with you for a minute today. So we come to you, obviously, you know, I hate to have to come in and ask for more money, but EMS and public safety is sort of the common good type things. One of the things that we want to talk to you guys about is per capita funding and sort of how we got to the number where we got where we're sent to you guys. And this is at the beginning of the discussion, how that we want to have a fruitful sort of transparent open discussion about continued and sustainability of EMS funding and having the availability of EMS services for those times when you need it. Hopefully you never do, but it's always something that you want when it does happen. So if you guys don't, I don't know if you are aware or not, but healthcare is fundamentally broken. As much as our premiums continue to go up and all of that type of thing. Those that are providing the healthcare coverage aren't necessarily getting paid as much. Medicare, Medicaid, even your commercial payers aren't paying the cost of actual services. EMS is fundamentally, is even more unique, where we are only, we only get reimbursed for services that we actually provide. So what does that mean? We only get paid, or there's only a reimbursement if we actually take you to the hospital. So all the times that we come and pick you up out of the floor, and we reverse an opiate overdose, we treat a diabetic emergency at home, even a cardiac arrest, use all of the drugs and equipment in our ambulances, no one pays for that. No insurances will reimburse for that. You can bill the patient, but they're not, there's not any way or mechanism for them to pay, and there's not any necessarily recourse if they don't pay, because we're not going to, if they call us again next week, we're not going to come, if that makes sense. We're definitely going to provide that service. So it's a really weird sort of paradigm that EMS is only paid for that. We're not necessarily paid for readiness and being availability to respond. So like other industries, our operating costs are going up, capital costs are going up, and I've already kind of talked about insurance going down. So let's talk about the big ticket item first, because that's sort of the easy one, is that an ambulance itself, box, chassis, equipment with full of life-saving equipment, heart monitors, stretchers, that type of thing, tops out just over $300,000. So that's before we put any trained medical providers on there. Right out of the gate, you're over $300,000 just to put one on the road. So obviously, that is a huge strain. And all of those items are biomedical equipment, so they all have lifespans on them. Just like our phones go outdated in 2 years, those heart monitors at $30,000 the manufacturers will stop servicing those after 6 or 7 years, and they become outdated because technology is moving so fast. So getting into the actual operational piece. So for years now, Bank and Rescue has sort of survived on the generosity of the towns, the folks in the towns. We have a sizable investment, which we'll talk about in a minute. And the interest from that has sort of washed away some of the actual, made our numbers at the end of the year look good or look solid. But if you start to look at the actual us recouping our operational costs, year after year, we lose about $55 every time we go out the door. All of you that own businesses or affiliate with businesses know that that is not a sustainable model. If every time you do a job, you're losing money. I was brought on board in late 2013. The board charged me with getting us back sort of in line. We have reduced our losses. We put a ton of processes in place, and I'll talk about those in a second, and got us down to sort of where we were before. However, there's not a ton of meat left on the bone. We're at the point where we might have to consider cutting services or other sort of drastic actions. So you're probably asking yourself, where is all this coming from? So on the top part here, this one's the easy part to talk about, is our transport business. So patients that need to get from a hospital to a nursing home or a hospital to another hospital, those are all billable services. Those are all things that we do get paid for. The 911 business, one out of every four calls are calls that are not reimbursable. So those are the ones you pick up off the floor, the ones that you go and potentially go to a cardiac arrest and not being able to transport. Those are all non-billable services. You can see a little bit of red up here, and those are ones that we work with the hospital on, and we both sort of take a hit because we're always going to do what's right for the patient. So this is sort of where the gap is. This is where our biggest hit is. This is why that cost per call or that loss per call continues to hang around year in and year out. And actually, and that's our overall numbers. For Shaftsbury, it's actually even higher. 43% of the time we come to the Shaftsbury area is a non-billable service. So it's something that we can't recoup any money for. So natural question, I would ask the same thing. Forrest, what have you done so far to fix this problem yourself? So we actually have cut staffing the last 3 years. We've reduced our available unit hours on a day-to-day basis to where there's not as many ambulances available. We are meeting our demand as it's presented to us, but there is absolutely there's no extra in there. There's the minimum amount of staffing all the time, and that's sort of all we have. That's all we get. We've really focused on our clinical and administrative supply costs. We've put really aggressive vehicle maintenance and preventative maintenance and replacement plans in place. Obviously, all the normal stuff, renegotiated supply contracts. We're trying to address some of those high utilizers, those folks that call multiple times a day or week that are a drain on resources, both for us and the hospital. And we're partnering with people like SVMC to try to keep those people from calling EMS and keeping them out of the ED. And it's because people, where we want people to be is healthy and at home, doing, you know, doing things that they want to do. Ultimately, the best case scenario is that you don't have an injury or illness, you don't need EMS, you don't need to go to the doctor, you don't need to go to the hospital. But ultimately, that happens. And then,
is this the high utilizers, are those people that we hear about relative to insurance, people who don't have insurance who end up in the ER whenever they need medical attention? Is that who we're talking
potentially
about?
Potentially, or folks that just either are either part of other systems or potentially just utilize, it's we're the low-hanging fruit. You can call 911, you know, anywhere from, you might have a medical emergency, you might not know any better, you could be scared, or like on a night like tonight, you need a warm place to stay, you call 911. These folks will show up, professionals will take you to a nice warm place, the hospital will evaluate you, they have to see you, and then, you know, or you have replaced your primary care physician with calling EMS. So I have toe pain, I'm gonna call an ambulance. I have dental pain, I'm gonna call an ambulance. I have chest pain, I'm gonna call an ambulance. So every ache and pain, something that most of us would go see our primary care physician or go to a clinic the next day, we become that default sort of utilizer. And once again, it's one of those things where we don't want necessarily stop. We want people, if they're scared, to call 911, but it's sort of the education piece, and that's prevalent across the U.S. as far as high utilizers. And then you'll see myself, Bill, and some other of our administration on the ambulances a lot as well. So we're doing everything possible to try to, you know, get our bottom line in order. In addition to saving money, our billing office does phenomenal. We meet or exceed industry standards as far as the amount of reimbursement we get. So much so that we've started farming that out to other agencies and providing that as a contracted service for other EMS agencies. So, you know, that's a revenue stream for us. It's not a huge revenue stream, but it is a revenue stream. We have participated in fundraising campaign. Thank you guys, those of you that donated. We have had other events, which I'm sure you've seen, Rescue Fest, which is a community event. We try to bring some people in. We had a band, get some fundraiser. We're constantly applying for grants, large ones and small, more successful in a lot of the smaller ones. Some of the bigger ones are sort of hit and miss, and we're always taking donations. In addition to that, we our education, which I was talking before the meeting, we're providing a lot of it, as you know, EMS professionals need that to stay current on their, keep their licenses up. But now our educational component, that's something else that we're outsourcing. It is something that we're able to get some money for. Once again, not a huge revenue stream. You're talking, you know, very, very, very small margins. We have some other contracts with the Department of Health, Medical Reserve Corps to provide some administrative services. Once again, not a huge revenue generator, but it is. We're trying to solve this problem on our own.
Can I make?
Yes.
I can remember years ago that a lot of people would leave money, you know, upon their death. Donations would be made to the rescue squad. Mm-hmm. I haven't seen that in the last few years. Is that because you've gone to rather than just a volunteer system, you've gone to a professional or a paid, almost a for-profit? Are you for-profit?
No, we're a non-profit.
You're a non-profit?
Yes, sir.
But you're now paying
correct
your people and that sort of stuff. I just don't see anybody leaving money to the rescue squad like they did.
There is very few. I think that's there's probably a couple reasons. One, I think there was sort of a feeling when we switched to from a volunteer to a career-based service, you know, in the early 2000s, that some people, I think our organization didn't feel it was right to necessarily promote that. We still have some that we occasionally get it. Like you said, it happens, it trickles in. I think that us making that awareness to folks that it's still a viable option. We still are 501c3. We still survive strictly on the amount of insurance reimbursements that we get and donations. That's probably some of the reason that it hasn't necessarily been as much recently. So what is our proposal? The proposal is $1,213 per capita for EMS funding. So that's a dollar a person a month, if you want to think about that. So I'm sure you're wanting to know, and I'll do the math for you, that the ask that we sent to you folks was the $42,685. Before we get on to that a little bit more, I'm sure you're probably asking yourselves, so what else do other folks pay? So right now, Bennington actually provides no funding for EMS, and we are having the same similar conversation that I'm sure you guys read the banner over the last month or so with them as well.
They don't pay taxes there.
That's correct.
Okay. What was that?
They get exempt from paying taxes on their property.
On our property.
On their facility, so that isn't quite true.
Yeah, there's a small amount in there. Woodford and Shaftsbury, you guys are actually leading the pack as far as EMS funding for Bennington Rescue, so we applaud you for that. But as you can see, some of our closest neighbors are way above as far as the 12-13. Some even up in the $20 or $30, and this range goes from anywhere in the low dollars up to the hundreds of dollars per person, which is depending on where you're at in Vermont.
Want to explain Arlington to me? What's that saying?
1432.
But that Arlington has their own rescue squad.
That's correct.
Okay.
So they're not given. This is what the town pays for EMS.
The town of Arlington.
Yes, sir.
Pays Bennington.
No, they pay Arlington.
Pay Arlington.
Yes, sir.
14 per.
Because person. We ask town of Shaftsbury gives Arlington money.
Correct.
Okay.
So the 12-13 puts us below the statewide median at 1508. Like I said, we just need a little bit of help. And like I said, we're here early to sort of have these discussions. So a couple of questions. One that comes up very common is that we do transfers. So why do you do transfers, and doesn't that limit the availability of ambulances? So we only do the transfer business when we have ambulances available for emergencies. So go back to business school 101, I'm sure. Well, if you're hurting on business and somebody's offering you business, you take the business, you make the money, you start solving your problem. Biggest problem is that we're at a point now where I'm sure the community doesn't want me to take my last available ambulance and to take a transfer out of town or make it unavailable. So then if you called 911, there could be a delay. As little as 10 or 15 minutes, as long as an hour, depending on where that ambulance was going. We are here to serve the needs of the community. Sometimes you need specialized care, so we take that you might need a specialist at Dartmouth or at Albany Med or someplace like that. So we have to take you there, and ultimately it's not just an emergency business. We are to get you to the care that you need. That right now is subsidizing our 911 business. So the fact that that's very green is helping to offset some of that red and allow us. That's allowing us to have this conversation in 2016 instead of coming to you folks in 2005 or 2002, back when probably would have. Yeah, I think if this agency wasn't as good as it was in the years coming up to it, I think this conversation would have happened a long time ago. And then the last piece is that, and back on your point, Mr. Whitman, is that we have a sizable savings. We have had a lot of folks donate money over the years, and we do have a good amount of money in the bank. Right now, our trust is a little under $3 million. When I took over, it was a lot closer to $4 million. What we've projected out is that based on our sort of supporting operations and replacing our capital stuff, our capital equipment, and of course building maintenance and all the other normal things, is that we're sort of in this death spiral where in the next 5 to 6 years, that savings is going to get depleted, and we're worried about having to come to you in 3 or 4 years for a really large amount of money, saying like we're not going to be able to stay open, and that's the reason we're trying to start this conversation earlier, to try to stop this before it happens and before everything is depleted and before everything goes away. So last little piece here is that we are, like you said before, we are a 24/7 fully staffed professional EMS agency. We are the only agency in Vermont right now that has achieved the silver status for the American Heart Association for our cardiac care. We are meeting or exceeding national benchmarks to get you to a cath lab. So if you have chest pain or have an issue in our service area, there's a very high probability that we're going to catch it. We're going to get you to a cath lab, and you'll have a very positive outcome. Back on the high utilizer piece, we were recognized this year from Dr. Harry Chen for our contributions to community paramedicine as far as trying to keep those high utilizers at home safe, healthy, trying to keep people from getting sick, getting injured, and getting to the hospital. And they're recognizing us for this, and as a very national movement. The goal in the next X amount of years is that becomes a reimbursable service where we get paid because the community itself is healthier and people aren't using EMS as much. That would be fantastic. And we are, we just recently received, we're the only agency in the Southwest Vermont. We're now a critical care agency, which means that we have paramedics that have even a higher level of skill where they can take ventilators, multiple drips, other medications, procedures, that type of thing out of the hospital and take you to tertiary care centers. And we're only the seventh agency in Vermont to get that designation. So really exciting stuff. And the last piece I'll tell you all this is that all of this data and this presentation was built on stuff that we've been working on over the last year or so and fantastic work from my board. But I can tell you that in healthcare, like a lot of us right now, is that we're not necessarily sure what happens January 21st. So healthcare could get a lot better. It could get a lot worse. It could stay the same.
Can't get any worse.
This is true.
Oh, sure can.
So there's a lot of unknowns, but we're here and we're hoping to at least start the dialogue to figuring out some sort of sustainable funding for sort of that uncompensated care, which is just such a hard thing to grasp. So I'll take any questions, and you guys have copies of this in front of you if there's anything that you need.
How many EMTs do you have on staff now? I mean, there's 14 in that picture or something, right?
Our staffing is just under 40. I think our, what's our
40,
current
24/7 around the clock.
Not on the clock at the same time, obviously.
Yeah, obviously. Yeah, but I mean to maintain a 24/7
correct
availability.
We have about 18 full-time staff.
13
clinical.
13 clinical. We have roughly 18 EMTs, 5 advanced emergency medical technicians, and 12 paramedics, counting the two of us, I think.
So that's a total staff of how many?
Well, then there's also some office staff in there, our billing staff. So there's another 4 folks. It's a lot of part-time.
38.
Where are we at? Is that up to 30?
48. I mean, I got 13 clinicals, 18 EMTs, 5 advanced care, and 12 paramedics. So that's 30, 43, 48.
So how many ambulances do you have?
6.
And how many calls per day do you make?
17 is our average. And what I will say is that it would be awesome if all the calls were spaced out evenly, and you know, you could our staffing meets our demand, and just, you know, middle of the night we have a lot less ambulances on duty. Middle of the day when we're moving a lot of folks, there's, you know, during the day you'll have 3 or 4 ambulances on. Middle of the night you'll have 1.5 to 2.
And how old is your oldest ambulance, the one that you're going to get ready to replace first?
It's
7 years old and has 156,000 miles on it.
It's about 2010 or?
Yeah, it's a Ford diesel, so it's not exactly, there are a few model years there where the diesel engine was not cutting it so well. It's really a very high cost to maintain the vehicle.
Do you understand how our community appropriations works for our town? It's a separate vote.
Yes.
Everything that he read off is listed.
Yes.
Right on through. People can check yes or no on on each one of them. I'm concerned that if you put down $40,000,
sure,
you're going to get a no.
Sure.
You won't get anything.
And I believe, and I apologize for that process and that process error on my part. We got some of our wires crossed, and I'll take the blame for that. We wanted to come to you guys early, and sort of our goal would be that this becomes more of sort of an ongoing, where it doesn't go to the vote every year, where it's baked into town budgets as a line item for the provision of emergency medical care. That would be the ultimate thing for us, because folks are always going to need EMS care. And I agree with you too. I think there might be some sticker shock as well. Myself and our board is absolutely willing to discuss a lot of options and to figure out what would make the most sense.
Has something changed in the way your funding goes? Because, I mean, I haven't had to call you guys in over 3 years. I had my wife two or three times.
Mm-hmm.
And you said you don't get paid for an emergency call, for a 911 call?
No, it depends. So if we transport you to the hospital, we will get reimbursed for that. But if we come to your house and you don't go to the hospital, or basically if you don't go to the hospital, if we don't put you in the back of the ambulance and take you somewhere, it's a non-reimbursable service.
Okay, because I always got, or my insurance company did, I always got bills.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And then I guess the only other question I would have is, in the last 2 or 3 years, have you changed how you locate a call? What are you going to? As far as finding the house. My house, I've got a business sign, a lighted business sign.
Okay.
In front of my house.
Okay.
I've got 911 number on my mailbox.
Okay.
All three calls that was made for my wife, ambulance went right by the house.
Gotcha. I can't speak to the specifics on that, but if there's an issue with mapping or dispatching, we obviously can investigate.
Well, this was a while ago. That's why I'm saying, has anything changed?
So there is now, there's been a big push for mapping and GIS location in Vermont. So, you know, there's actually now a website that our supervisor usually always has up. It's a 911 viewer as far as where your addresses actually are and how to get there. We try to keep crews up to date on every possible location as far as, you know, as new developments pop up, that type of thing.
Yeah.
Why we missed that on those specific things, I can't tell you.
Well, I'm just asking. I mean, they got there and they got her to the hospital,
good.
You know, that was, like I said, that was years ago.
I've heard a concern from people that have used your service. For instance, if somebody falls at Fillmore Pond or whatever it's called now, they're picked up and taken to the hospital, checked out, unless they're, I assume, get reimbursed for that. Is that not right? Because obviously they're Medicare, because they'd be that old. Then that person is released from the hospital and they call up and say, we'd like a transport back. And they say, yeah, but be prepared to pay $500 or $800.
And there is, so, and that's where, back to the original slide of healthcare is broken. So if there is, there's a specific set of necessary criteria that patients have to meet before an ambulance service is warranted. So for us to take a patient from the hospital to a nursing home, a doctor has to sign off on a certain specific set of criteria, and they have to meet certain criteria for that to be billable
you'll be reimbursed.
Correct. Otherwise, and then one of the things that we have to advise the patient, and that's probably where you're hearing some of this, is that we've become very transparent in our practices. And there's a thing called an advanced beneficiary notice. And what that is, what we tell the patients is that we need to make you aware up front that there's a chance that your insurance may not cover this expense. You need to be aware of it beforehand. And we make sure that they sign a document saying that there's a chance that your insurance will kick this out. We obviously, on our side, work really hard to fight through every appeal, every denial, trying to make sure that the patient's not hit with those. But that is something that we actually are required to do as far as letting people know that sometimes things aren't covered.
It's sounding sort of like the whole thing where that if you did take that person back and charge them $800, you're almost like it doesn't sound like it's necessary to charge $800 to go from the hospital back to Fillmore Pond. Are you charging extra just to cover all the other losses that you lose?
No. So our charge structure is pretty standard as far as Vermont and for this region. What federal payers will tell you, and this is what, if you've heard Don George or some of those folks in like Blue Cross Blue Shield or MVP talk about cost shifting, is that we set our rates, and federal payers like Medicare, Medicaid, those types of folks, we could charge, I'll use a crazy number, thousands of dollars, and Medicare says, that's nice, we're going to give you $216.12. Yep. We raise our rates the next year, Medicare comes back and says, that's nice, we're going to give you $216. And then what they say is, for playing in our sort of billing system or being a Medicare provider, you're going to take this and you're going to be happy with this amount regardless of what your costs are. Your commercial payers typically do pay 80 or 90% of the actual charges. Are the rates inflated? No. They're just, that's sort of the cost of doing business.
Sounds expensive.
It is.
Do you have a standard rate for, or can you not have, in other words, do you have like an hourly rate? Or how do you figure the rate?
There's a loading fee and then a mileage fee. So there's a mount just to put you in the ambulance. And then there's a trip from the hospital to Fillmore Pond would be a lot less than a trip from the hospital to Albany Med.
Yeah, because you...
There's more miles involved.
You're just like it out of the rate, but you're using miles instead of an hour.
Sure, yes. The other thing, and your comment made another question pop up in my brain, is that why can't we offer discounts? And there's a sort of below the, why can't we offer a really cheap rate to get you back to Fillmore Pond? And the thing is that those same federal payers, it's sort of this double-edged sword. So we potentially could offer a really cheap rate, but then Medicare and Medicaid comes in and says, well, since you'll do that for this one trip, then you can do it for everything. So we're going to reduce your actual reimbursement structure for everything. So that's why you don't see EMS discounted below Medicare rates. They sort of, and now all the other commercial insurers are sort of following suit as far as whatever Medicare, Medicaid sort of sets the rules as, everyone else is kind of following behind.
Are there other ambulance services serving in the Bennington area? I mean, I've seen other ambulance services, but are they picking up Bennington people or are they just
The hospital can choose whatever vendor they want for actual transport business. Okay. We are the 911 provider for Bennington, Shaftsbury, or for the majority of Shaftsbury and Woodford. As far as other agencies, if the hospital calls other agencies to do other transfers or things like that, that's absolutely, or the patient requests. If the patient lives in Cambridge and wants Cambridge to drive down and pick them up and take them back, that's totally the patient's choice.
What I was in the 2 years ago, they sent me to Albany, Mass.
Mm-hmm.
Why did Deerfield Valley take me down there instead of you guys?
That is, once again, the hospital can choose. We may or may not have a crew available. I'm not sure. They can choose the next choice. They can choose another provider. I can't speak to the specifics of why that was chosen that exact day.
They run out of Wellington, don't they?
That's correct.
That don't make no sense.
It is complex.
So, not knowing what I'm talking about, but just walking in, not having thought about it before, a staff of 48 and 6 ambulances seems like a lot for a community of 20, 30,000 people. How do you decide that that's the number you have to have and that you can't cut staff and ambulances more?
So the actual, excellent question. So there is a percentage above your actual fleet that says your fleet is X. You need to have this many more ambulances because there's always one down for maintenance or wreck or, you know, whatever. Just like if you have plow trucks, you need to have an extra one because there's going to be one broken down when you need it or what have you. And then as far as the actual unit hours, we try to think of the best way to explain this.
So better.
Bill's our director of operations. He can probably articulate slightly better.
So what happens is that we always staff what we call plus one. So the demand, what we'll do is we'll take a 40 to 52 week rolling average and see what the demand is for every single hour of every single day. And then round it up to the closest whole integer and add one. And that is roughly, that's our 911 coverage is that plus one ambulance, and the rest is what we actually do in terms of transports. Because there is that 25% of 911 calls that don't result in a transport, and that isn't accounted for in a typical demand analysis because it's a non-paying job when we have to respond to it. So we're down to the point where our actual staff is probably about 35, I think. The 13 clinical, that was inclusive of the EMTs,
okay.
Paramedics. And so we end up with two units on 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, as that basic 911 coverage and ability to do one transfer. And then we have, on the weekdays when we're busier with 911 calls and transfers, we have an additional unit that's on for anywhere between 6 to 10 hours extra a day. And on some days it's not staffed. So on Tuesdays, for example, throughout this region, for some reason, it's not unique to us, but there's a low volume in the emergency department in 911 calls and transfer requests. It's the slowest day of the week.
Tuesday?
We can get by with two ambulances tomorrow.
So that's the day I want to have my heart attack.
we only do 11 calls on a Tuesday, where on a Friday, for example, we now do 20 to 22 calls on average on a Friday. So we have an extra 10-hour truck on Friday because we're so much busier on Fridays. They're trying to get everyone out of the hospital. People have been waiting all week with their medical maladies, and they decide to call 911 at that point instead. Whatever the circumstance may be, it's busier on Fridays now. So we change that every, usually 6 to 12 months, our staffing ratio. So not to mess with everyone's schedules too much either, work schedules, if that makes sense.
Yes, it does.
To answer your, and to piggyback on your last question, is our board looks hard at our entire fleet and all of our expenses constantly. And there's, that's the sixth truck is always a discussion point, and I can tell you that the truck that Bill told you might get replaced, as of right now, it's not slated to be replaced. We're actually thinking about dropping down to 5 trucks. It just depends on where it gets really precarious for us is that the lead time on an ambulance is right at a year. So if we get into a dire situation, I call tomorrow and order a truck, we're not going to see it till next Christmas or next December.
What makes it that long?
Because there's not necessarily lots full of them. They're sort of built to order nowadays.
Are they customized?
Yeah.
Like a fire truck.
Yes, very, very similar. Yeah, they're not standard.
The frame is not the issue. It's the
box.
What you put out.
And the fact that they're not, you know, they're taking, it's sort of like Boeing. They're only going to make so many planes or ambulances. They're not going to, you know, have a lot full of ambulances sitting around that you can just go grab.
Well, yeah, but that's, again, that's like a fire truck. You can't, you have to kind of customize each one for
what you need, yes, sir.
Right?
Mm-hmm. Correct. So,
are you still going to ask the town people of Shaftsbury for the $40,000, or would you think you'd be dropping it to a lower number?
We could potentially drop it. I mean, like I said, this is
entirely up to you because the way our system works. We can't go putting it in a line item this late.
For this year?
We can. We have other political concerns, including
sure.
a garage we've been trying to build for 7 years.
Yes.
That we're going to ask the voters to approve. We're hopeful we can get it past them this time if we don't raise taxes, because the school's already indicating they're going to be raising taxes this time.
Okay.
EMS is important, it's really up to us. I mean, we can. It's just, you know, will you get reelected if we do? I guess is the question.
And I guess the question would be for me is that at what point do you want to know the actual final number? And I know the deadline the previous application process was mid-November. When would you want to see that number edited? And then if you were going to put it in as a potential line item, what would be your guys' sort of potential?
Mid-January.
Yeah.
Because we have to have it by mid-January if we're going to talk about it again at a board meeting. And the deadline for getting the ballots is January 30th.
Okay.
So mid-January if we want to change the number. And one thing about the number I noticed, I think it based it on our entire population. And we're paying Arlington for everything north of the chocolate barn, I believe. So you might want to adjust that a little bit.
Sure.
Yeah, I mean, I really think it's up to us. He's given his, pitch. And if we believe his numbers, it comes down to us. Do we want to leave it up to the community and leave it at the same number that it's at, leave it up to the community and raise the number? Or do we want to say we need to fund EMS for our population and put it in the budget? We could do a combination of both, but I'm not sure that that really makes sense. Because if they saw that we had added, a $10,000-$20,000 item to the line, to the budget, and then they saw another one on the on the ballot, that might confuse them or put them off. So,
sure. And I think one of the things that's we realize that we're coming and we realize we're sort of late to the budget cycle. We thought we were early, but we were mistaken. But we our board is willing to discuss this. We also realize that ultimately, yes. We did pass we're in the process of passing a negative budget ourselves again. We don't necessarily have to get all the way this year, but I think if we're at that point where we want to make sure that 2 or 3 years from now, we don't come to you guys saying like, we are broke, we have nothing, we don't know necessarily how we're going to do this. And I think that a systematic sort of integration or any other unique options you guys come up with, I think we are absolutely for. I believe that's.
Do you have any idea how it's going to go with Bennington? I know you're asking them for about $200,000.
They are going to. We're going to discuss it again in January, and then a few of the select folks from there. I think a smaller subcommittee is going to talk to them or talk with us and our board about some strategies. I think they kind of want to investigate some of the things that we've already kind of given them, which is totally fine. And see if there's other sort of creative options. The outcome of that, I don't know. Obviously, I hope it. Once again, I hope that we start to work towards a solution. Every little bit helps.
Mm-hmm. Well, if there are no other questions, I think we've got.
What is? Does Powell have a rescue?
Yes.
Rescue vehicle.
They have two ambulances.
Oh, that's all volunteer, is that, or is that?
I'm not exactly sure their payment structure. I believe they're either paid per call or they're paid. It's a combination of volunteer, paid per call, and also paid on shift, but I don't know their structure nor their sort of how exactly they are operated.
So it looks like Shaftsbury is the only one that relies on other towns. Powell's got their own, Arlington's got their own. I mean, right in this group.
Right here.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting.
Okay. All right. Well, we probably should let you go.
Sure.
And let us take up the discussion and see how
All right. We
want to do it.
One thing I will offer is our board is meeting on Wednesday night, so I'll take the information that you guys have shared back to them, and depending on your guys' outcome of your discussion, maybe we can touch base again in January and find maybe a happy medium somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
So we appreciate your guys' time and appreciate your discussion.
Thank you.
Thank you guys for...
Let me give you your little gadget back here. Let's see if there's a... If it wants to eject.
There shouldn't be.
No. All right.
Thank you.
So, from the board, what are your thoughts?
I think it's a pretty steep jump for 1 year to come out of the blue. It's a necessary service. So, I guess the question, will that funding, if we were to say you got everything you wanted from Bennington, would you start building up your coffers, or would you still be...
That gets us to zero.
Okay. The projection. And you projected that out, 2021 in there, right?
Yes, sir. We build our projections on 3 to 5 years, sort of where we're at, depending on how healthcare changes, and sort of the current status as of October 2016.
Okay.
I don't think we can put it as a line item on the community appraisals. I guess we got to put a number in our budget.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
But what that, I'm not quite ready for $40,000 this year. But it's Dave's got to work his magic.
Yeah.
Well, I think Dave has worked as much magic as he can. Our budget is a turn up with no blood in it. If we're going to add a number, I'll pick a number. I'll say half that this year and the full amount next year. It's going to require that we raise taxes a half penny this year and a full penny next year. And I agree with you. It's an essential service. Yep. It's like the fire department. It's not like the McCullough Library. It's something that we want to have and something that we ought to pay for.
Yep.
The only thing I would ask again is that because we have two services serving the town,
sure,
we don't want overlap of, you're asking for one part, I can't go to Arlington, they should come down and say, well, we want to be paid for the other 2/3 of the town then. So if you could tighten that number up, it would be helpful. And I'm not sure where that line wiggles through town, where the cutoff is, or even if it's official, but I know it's official, but if you could work that out, just as an equity thing with Arlington.
Yeah, that's a good point, because we could find ourselves,
because they do provide...
They might come in next year and say they want $12 a person, and we've got double coverage at that point. So, not a problem yet. I mean, at this point, Arlington's getting $7,000 or something.
That's what they've asked for again. And that's not an issue, but just things to keep off the table.
Well, we don't have to decide tonight, but I would agree with you about the line item, and I think, as the number I suggested, maybe 20,000 get us halfway there, and taxes would likely have to go up. I don't think we've got much room.
Yeah, right now they're going up 1%, and I'm raising revenues 1% by collecting the clerk's fees, so we're at level. There's no way, and I'll look, but trimming 20,000 off is going to be, this is a pretty tight budget.
If by some magic Morton comes back with a really lower than expected, been thinking about the building's going to cost us maybe 700,000. If it only cost us 600,000, like we were talking before, maybe the bond note isn't the full 75 we've been putting away, and we've got a little wiggle room.
That would be easy to look at in the fiscal 19 budget, but with the time lock on this, it'd be hard to do. But
when does that equipment we get on loan to pay off then?
Well, don't forget, all that money is targeted already. That's targeted for our own fire truck replacement, highway equipment. Yeah, see, there is nothing left.
As those numbers go down, we have to start setting
up. Oh, yeah, no, next time. Right.
I mean, there's always some place, but coming up with 40 this year would be tough.
Something
would suffer. There's no way at this point.
Well, if you're going to put it in the budget, you can't put it on the appropriate, on the vote on appropriations.
Yeah.
Too.
But in other towns, when they have big things like this, like towns that don't have fire departments, so they're contracting with the neighborhood fire department, it's not an appropriation, it's in the budget.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Okay. No, I don't know what the number is, but it's got to be a line item.
Agreed.
Yeah.
All right. All right, let's all chew on that until January 2nd, and then all will become clear after Christmas, I'm sure. All right.
And maybe you could provide us with if your board talks, and maybe work that number a little bit to give us some idea. That'd be good.
Okay. All right, let's move on by moving backward to our...
Well, we still have a number of appropriations, or do you want to go back
to those? Well, how about we jump back and let Melanie give her treasurer's report?
She's nodding her head, yeah.
Since we skipped over you because you were off gallivanting somewhere.
I was playing a holiday concert at the North Bennington School.
Likely story.
I bet you got a standing ovation, too.
I don't think we did, actually, now that you mention it. Do you have the treasurer's report?
I do.
Okay. This is one of these mid-month ones that I don't think are terribly interesting, but I can walk through some of the revenues there that might need a little explanation. You can see there's a big interfund transfer. That represents money that was already spent in the reserve funds, and it's just correcting for the due from. So it's every time you write a check out of a reserve account, since the check is actually written out of the general fund, you have to send it back. And so it had been building up for a while. And Dave, especially because he was working on the budget, wanted to have a little more transparency about where the cash actually is. So did you put the reserve fund spreadsheet in the?
I did not.
I don't think it's really necessary. It just it shows that where the money is coming from, basically.
Yeah.
So that's what that big amount of money is. It's not anything. It's not new receipts. It's just making the general fund whole for what was already spent.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see. Is there anything else interesting there?
Is delinquent taxes money that's been come in late, or is that what's owed to us?
That was receipts of the first chunk of delinquent taxes that came in since the due date.
Okay, all right.
There probably will have a couple of big ones coming, I imagine. So that was a very early one.
Okay.
Okay, if you want to look at the disbursements, a lot of that...
What's
that,
Fund 840, just out of curiosity?
Pardon me?
Fund 840, what is that?
Oh, okay, that was making that was the... 840 is the escrow account, and that was after discussions with the external auditors. It was weird that there was some leftover money in that. It was from years ago, before my time, and I talked with them and said, I don't see why escrow money is in with other money. I don't think it belongs there. I think it should be separate. And so we cleared that out, and next time we have a tax sale, if there's money for us to hold in escrow, I'm going to create a new bank account, because I just don't like having all that money be blended in together. It just seems strange.
Mm-hmm.
So that was after discussions with Sullivan Powers. That other transfer was also a result of a Sullivan Powers thing. There was something that a mistake, that host town transfer reversal, something that I found, and then they found it too, and so I had to undo what I had already done because they obviously did it the official way and I hadn't, so that's what that is.
Okay.
The checks written in December, that includes the purchase of the property over by the transfer.
Yeah, we signed that warrant tonight.
Yeah, right. So that's it.
Okay.
I didn't project it to budget because it's halfway through the month, but you'll see that next time.
Okay.
Any questions about any of this or anything else?
We're still solvent.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Oh, there was one other thing I wanted to mention, actually. I got several requests this year, more than last year, of people wishing that they could pay with a credit card. And last year, I kind of dismissed it out of hand because the fees are so high, but it looks like they've come down or they've worn me down. But the clerks and treasurers were all talking about the service that I thought I would look into, that we could put something right on our website so people could pay with a credit card, and this outside party sort of takes care of everything. There's no cost to us. It's a fairly hefty cost to the taxpayer.
Oh, to them.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But there's no cost to the town. But for the convenience of people who realize it's November 15th and I'm in California and the post office is closed, they could mm-hmm. still get in under the wire. So it is worth it to a select number of people. And so I thought I would look into that. Since there's no cost to the town, it seems like kind of a no-brainer.
Never heard of that.
It's called, the service is Municipay.
I've run into that, I think, with my car license. I think Vermont does it, is if you pay your car license with a
credit card.
Oh, right, there's a fee associated with it.
There's a fee that pops up, and it's a really big one, and they don't tell you until you're done.
Right, yeah. Well, we would be kinder about telling.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like 2%, which, when you're looking at a tax bill, that's, that's a lot of money. It'd be $80 or $90.
Yeah, but better than the 8% late fees. So. Yeah.
Exactly, yeah. Right. And sure. And we also were figuring that that maybe with the change in, that some people might want to pay for dog licenses and things like that. So if we had it available as for all payments, right?
Yeah, even for people who come in, minor fees to the clerk, and they want to use a debit card, and we have no way of doing it.
And more people are expecting that. Every year there are going to be more.
Absolutely.
Cashless society.
Do you have a reason to think that people are late on their taxes because of not being able
to
pay?
There's always a handful of people. I get some calls who say, cut me a break. It was not my fault. I didn't get the bill. They say they didn't get the bill in time, and they're far away or they're traveling. There's always a handful.
Uh-huh.
And, I can't, but.
Yeah, I mean, I don't see a downside if we can get the proper controls on mm-hmm. it, so it's safe and secure, and people are willing to pay the 2% themselves.
What you're going to run into is that if they make the payment to that company on the last day, but the company doesn't give it to us until several days later, are they delinquent?
Oh, no, as far as I'm concerned, they would not be delinquent. I mean, I'm already taking postmark. I mean, it seems to me that at the moment that the transaction happened, if it's before the deadline,
okay.
that's on time as far as I'm concerned.
Okay. Yeah, yeah, I think that would be up to us to decide, and we would be, we'd be generous in that way. Okay, so you're going to look into that?
So I'll go forward with that. I'll report on it next time.
Yeah, and let's make sure we're confident about this company, too, because 2% sounds like a low number.
I don't know what, please don't quote me on that. It was something like that, and I remember thinking it was very high before, and this time I didn't think it was so high, and maybe it's only I have changed in the meantime, not it. But the treasurers from other towns, we have this sort of a communication, and a lot of them were saying that it's working out great for them.
Mm-hmm.
So, and it's more of them get it every year. So,
because Art, you probably know what credit cards charge you for. It's 3%
and 1.5% to 3%.
It
depends on the volume and the credit card.
Okay.
American Express is more than anybody else, and in of course it's your volume and all that sort of stuff. Mm-hmm. But it's close to 2%.
Okay. That
averages out easily.
Okay.
But
so
for this like this, I can't imagine they're doing it for 2% for just the little volume that they would have there. So
Sounds like it's a pretty big volume. Municipay
is a very large company. That,
yeah, so
does
1% of
the design
all the money.
To take care of small organizations.
Oh, so they're clustering.
Yeah,
that's
towns.
True.
Okay.
So maybe they are doing it for less than the price.
Yeah,
of
I like
mean,
the idea.
We could speculate forever, but I can actually find out and report back.
Okay. Yeah, sounds good. Okay. Thank you. All right, back to community appropriations. We had a few people. It looked like did they just, instead of going through the process, sent a letter to the town clerk or to you and say, can you do this for us?
Well, yeah, everyone in the state got one from the group you have up there, Big Heavy World. which, if you read this, it's some music group from Burlington who sent this request to basically every town in the state.
Mm-hmm.
It's not clear to me at all what they would do for us here at all. They have a very nice website that I went through, but again, I couldn't see where it really transforms to anything here, or if they would even come down this way, especially if we were the only town that contributed to it.
Mm-hmm.
Did they meet the deadline?
No, they did not. They never even sent anything to Bob.
Okay.
Yeah, they didn't jump through the hoops. They just sent a letter here and said, can you do it for us? And I've gotten those over the years from a number of different places, and I'll usually check them out and see if there's if I think there's something essential, and if they're not, I just toss them, because you know, we have a process.
Yeah,
they didn't meet the deadline.
Yeah, we have Park McCullough also did not submit anything on time, and I have their letter here, the same letter that we get every year from them.
Okay, well, they know the process because they've been through it a few times, so they should know better.
Yeah, I checked, double checked with Bob, and he said that, and he hadn't had anything submitted directly to him. And I got this letter.
Financial report and everything.
He had sent me a little thing, an email exchange he had with someone there that does, oh no, that's the library, I'm sorry. No, nothing they, from the house at all.
Park McCullough was on there last year?
Yes.
And they were approved by the voters?
I believe so, yes. I can tell you.
Yeah, everybody was approved.
Yeah, everybody was approved last year.
Last year they were, there was one year that one or two of them went down.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. We might choose to treat Park McCullough differently just because they're our neighbor and they were there last year and the voters approved the vote, and the voters might want to continue that funding. Mm-hmm. The music thing, I'm less inclined to make an exception for them.
We also have Vermont Rural Fire Protection, which Bob tells me has never applied here before. This is quite a common one around the state.
This is one that I've gotten letters from before, and I have spoken to Joe Vatican about Vermont Rural Fire Protection Task Force, and he had never heard of them.
Wow.
Based on that, I decided not to bring it any further. Like I said, I get these from time to time, and if I think there's something that is worthy of attention, I'll bring it up, but we if our fire chief hasn't heard of it, that's...
Well, we certainly support our fire departments. So.
Yeah. Surprisingly. Okay.
So I'm not inclined to make an exception for this one.
And we have two changes in the amounts from last year. Both of them the libraries. Martha Canfield out of Arlington asked for $2,100. That's $400 less than last year. And Bennington Free Library requested $16,750, which is $750 more than last year. And everyone else, putting aside Bennington Rescue Program, everybody else asked for the same amount as last year.
Okay.
So it's all
okay.
Pretty much the same. So what we will do is not Vermont Fire, Rural Fire Protection, Big Heavy World, and Park McCullough we're going to put in, though. Is that correct?
I think we should.
I'll make a motion
to include
Park McCullough.
Yeah.
All right.
On the appropriations.
Mitch has made a motion to make an exception for Park McCullough and approve them for a ballot appropriation in the amount of $1,000.
I'll second.
Seconded by Art.
For the last time, if they don't get their paperwork in next year.
Yes. And, you know, we could do something that we have talked about doing every year, which is get that process up on our website and make it clear and put those deadlines on the calendar so that people can see them. We've said we were going to do that and we haven't done that, so there's an action item for you.
Well, I think we're going to have no choice next year because Bob's not going to do it anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll have to set up a stricter program for us to do this and get everybody notified and have this all taken care of.
Stricter.
It's a historical scenario.
Any more discussion on Mitch's motion to approve Park McCullough's exception to appear on the ballot? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. So the motion is agreed to 400. Park McCullough will be allowed to place a $1,000 community appropriation on the ballot. All right. Is there any more discussion of community appropriations?
Talking to a selectman or person that was a selectman years ago, who I think when he was on the board, they actually came up with the protocol that in order for somebody to be have their item placed on the ballot, of course it had to be placed on the ballot because it had to go to print before, but if they did not come to town meeting on Monday night, stand up and give a pitch for the thing, offer financial statements if asked for, even if it was voted, they would not get it. They had to be there Monday night.
I had heard that too, and I had asked about that. I think one of the reasons they moved away from it was because of the numbers we have.
It turned
into quite an extended discussion over some parts of it.
Yeah.
But you're correct, because I looked into it with Judy about how this went in the past, and everyone who wanted an appropriation had to have a representative at town meeting.
Yeah, just a point. I'm not saying we go back to it, but I'm just saying that we've strayed from what was set up several years ago.
Well, and I would even question if that's still legal,
well,
because the state does have very strict rules on what the select boards can and cannot do relative to community appropriations.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
If, for example, I know it's the case, if a group gets a 5% petition signed and comes in with an amount to go on the ballot, we have to put it on the ballot. Yeah. We're not allowed to,
well, it's just,
to change it.
Just a comment, okay?
Mm-hmm. Okay, takes us to 9, proposed new town garage and transfer station. We did buy the 510 North Road property. We have not gotten a cost estimate on the building from Morton yet. Dave tells me that is promised mid-January.
Mid-January, yes.
Which I've told him to ask Steve if he can do it sooner, because that's getting pretty close to our deadline of January 30th, which I think is going to force us to think about scenarios for that number and what we're going to do, because we can't come in on our last meeting before January 30th and be surprised by a building number and then try and figure out how we're going to go forward with it. So we need to be thinking about what kind of number we think we can go to the voters with, what we're going to do about the transfer station.
Okay, I'd like to talk about that. I think in the meantime, I haven't talked to Kenny about this, so I'm kind of springing this on him the last minute, but I think if we took from the edge of the property down to the transfer station and looked at what it would cost for materials only, our crew can build roads. They definitely have demonstrated they can build a road, okay? So all it is a road down to an area, to a flatter area, maybe some blocks and that sort of stuff. I can't believe all the blocks that he had in his estimate are necessary and all that sort of stuff. So if Kenny wants to take the roadway, figure out how many cubic yards.
Yeah.
And Barney's stuff for the bottom and fabric, and even if you have to go to Weaver or somebody like that.
If you're going to vary off the road that's already there, it's the only thing you've got to add. That road that's there,
I know.
I'm concerned, it's been there for.
Yeah. So there's no. I don't think there's any reason for 18 inches of gravel on top of a road that's been there for a long time. But anyways,
a road that's going to get a lot of traffic with dump trucks full of gravel. I mean, it's probably going to get more stress than it.
It's already had it. There's been trucks of all sizes and shapes going in and out of there. As long as that thing's been a landfill.
Yeah.
I don't know why you have to put in 5 cents of gravel in there, a lot of it.
Yeah. But anyways, I'd like to, our road crew can build that, get a better idea from Tam, just what he does need down there. Does it need to be that many blocks? I'll take that part of it, and I'll come back with what it would cost to create that down there. If he gets, there's no way it's, we have to spend that kind of money for that. So we'll have a lot better number for.
So you're saying down where? Down to the level spot that we cleared off?
No. When I say down, I meant further
toward,
down.
Toward North Airport Road?
No, towards the roadway, as you're going up to the brush pile,
mm-hmm.
that's where the transfer station would go.
Oh, move it back
there.
Yeah,
we take some of those trees down, but it occupies that roadway that currently goes up there.
Yeah.
I mean, you've got, the thing is a gravel pit anyway. You can use gravel that's on the site, then put down fabric if you need it, and put some top gravel on it. So instead of
keeping that as part of the front part, moving it back around a
little
bit farther up the road towards the back part.
Yeah, it's an easy.
No, it's not with fabric.
The design is basically what Tam said he needed. It's just this question of all this gravel and all these levels, and there's so many things on the transfer station portion that don't ring correct that mm-hmm. we can really trim an awful lot out. Even in around the building, there's still a lot of the site work that is for ground that's been pounded for years and years and years. But everything from the track excavator down, it's hard to believe it needs that much preparation for the same amount of trucks to be going in and out.
So that's moving the transfer station back to the old rough pile area?
Yes, rough.
And then, because
we have to have so many feet of setback.
Mm-hmm.
Town zoning bylaws say got to be so many feet so that's where it had to be.
So in that, instead of just putting it up close, still get rid of all the pole barn that we have now and move that, just set it up that section where the dumpsters would be drive by, throw it off way out back.
It's got to be. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, and that definitely that road was used to bring in sand and dirt for the cap and everything else.
Exactly.
There's many tons of.
Many tons
of.
I mean, the only real site work is where, because you'll come in this way and you'll make a loop, the trees will come down here. That's the only place where we really have to put new stone, fabric, and compound.
Right.
That'll be fresh earth, but the rest of it has been pounded for years. And 90% of the traffic we're talking about for the landfill site is passenger cars.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Tam will roll in a truck to get a container maybe a couple of times a week,
mm-hmm.
but it's not constant trucks.
Yeah, I misunderstood. I thought you were talking about the road down to the gravel pile.
No, when I said down below, I just meant further out. Okay.
Okay. How about a task for the garage committee to come up with a revised cost estimate?
Yes.
For the site plan work based on using town crew, labor, and other barter arrangements that Dave has been offered?
Yeah, we have people who want to do different things. Some people want the buildings. Some people want our forklift in exchange for doing work. And I've had people mention the trees. I mean, we can go out and find people in the community. Hey, if you want to take these trees down because there's valuable wood in them, then maybe we can work a way to get that done to everybody's satisfaction.
Isn't that a stand of red pine?
I don't know anything about trees. I'm
planted
sorry.
During that. Yeah.
Some people have told me they want.
Did you find out, Dave, about burning that other house that we
have? I haven't gotten to Joe about that yet. But that would be a good exercise, but it still has to be cleaned up, so it's still a trade.
But you're going to have a lot less to clean up.
I love that idea. I'm going to go out there and watch it burn.
Yeah.
You clean up the rats, too.
I think it's. I guess it's possible because it's been mentioned to me, so we'll figure that out.
So,
I think we need to tell the select board what we talked about having the drilling done.
We are going to have the geotech drilling done where the foundation of the garage is proposed to be, just to make sure we're not going to run into any long forgotten landfill area.
And then we can say with certainty to the public
that this is where it will fit. This is where it can be built.
Because everybody comes back and says, "Oh, you're on top of the landfill." Well,
yeah,
we are.
Yeah. And it's a simple. We're going to have to do it one way or the other. We were thinking of holding off until after the bond issue, but we might as well get this clear right now that the ground is fine right where we're proposing. And if we have to move it from here to here, then we'll know that. But there's no reason to expect it. But in discussions with Morton that we had last week, it seemed to be more practical to get this off the table.
It's a selling point, again.
Yeah, it's a selling point.
Look, we've had this.
It's there, it's done. Just like the fall water testing that just came back. It's the same report that comes back every single time.
Do you think we can have that by January 2?
Oh, yeah, yeah. I told them to do that immediately. So they're putting together. I should have a date at least by the end of this week. And that's just boring and
that's just a bore sample. Just
yeah,
like how many feet do they go down?
Yeah. Well, it depends. You know, 30, 40 feet. It depends on what they find as they're going.
They hit bedrock.
It's up to Morton.
It's up to them.
We told Morton to tell the drillers what to look for.
And they'll base it on their experience. That's, you know, why you hire them. And they could do two and just say, okay, there's nothing here. Maybe they do three.
Basically, you're going to do it where the foundation is going to be.
Where the foundation is what they're trying to see. So that
make sure you're not over something that's going to cave in.
Yeah, that would be preferable.
So it's pretty clear we've all decided where we're going to put the garage. We have not had a formal vote on that, but assuming we have the results of that drilling by January 2, can we all plan on having that vote on January 2 and say we're going to put the town garage on that site close to North Road?
Yep.
Okay. What else about the garage? Transfer station. Are we back to keeping the transfer station on our property?
Yes.
Have we exhausted all the avenues of possibility with moving it over across the street?
I think it's the best thing. We aren't going to get pushback from some public people about now that we've lost control, which is really not an arguing point, but it's on our property. We still manage it like we always did. It meets the setback,
mm-hmm.
which is, so.
And we'll have no problem being permitted there. It's just be easy. We're only moving it like 100 feet, so it's not a big issue.
Well, I think a lot of it depends on the work of the garage committee to come back and say it's not going to cost us $200,000.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I'll work hard on that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Good.
Anything more on the PFOAs, Dave?
No, the fall testing I received today, and I put it in the Dropbox. I have not read the whole thing. I spoke with KAS last week, and there's nothing out of the ordinary to report. But the reports are like 50 pages long, so I didn't read them this afternoon. But I did. I actually called them last week because it was another thing I wanted to check off regarding the garage. Like, you know, there's nothing exciting going on. There's nothing going on.
So just as kind of a informational point, I see in the news the other day that St. Gobain and Honeywell
mm-hmm.
reached an agreement with Hoosick Falls for something on the order of $900,000.
Yeah, which is just for their system. It still leaves the homeowners, the property owners still have many legal avenues to go down yet. Yeah. That just covers the towns. They're going to have a meeting in December, I understand, or in a couple of weeks with the taxpayers and the people affected to see if they want it approved. Good. But there's an interesting release by the state, too, about how they want Honeywell and St. Gobain to work closely with the Bennington area, which I like more than specifying towns because that kind of puts us in the Bennington area. I think it's all a matter of just it working itself through and come up with a political solution to this in Montpelier to how they're going to deal with all the towns.
Right. Yeah. Okay.
The report we just got on PFOA from, this is from KAS. There's a line at the end, the nature of the release, on-site waste disposal, coupled with the absence of VGES, that's the Vermont Standard exceedances, indicates further investigation and or remedial action is not warranted at this time. That's from KAS. They go on to say that they do know about the letter from October 2nd in which the DEC is discussing post-closure landfill management and the exceedances and
what we are discussing with them about that.
And as you recall, we have chosen not to act on that request for coming up with a plan for further testing.
Yep.
But I did like that KAS thought that the numbers around there indicate that no further investigation or remedial action is required, is warranted. And since we brought it up, the regular non-PFO, PFOA water quality test also came in, and it's pretty much like the ones we always get, a little bit high in iron. It's within historical norms. There was one blip in a well in lead, and the report did say that blip may be an indication of their testing method, and that it doesn't indicate a trend, and the idea is just to keep an eye on it. So if we saw, you know, if we see more lead pop up again, I'm sure the state will let us know that there's something to be concerned about there. But so far, it's just what we call a blip. We were going to, we promised that we would sign an extension of that host town tax agreement until we decide what we want to do about things.
Mm-hmm. The board needs to vote. We discussed this at a prior meeting. Merrill, our attorney, produced this agreement. Trevor has signed it for Tam already. If the board approves, you'll need to sign this in front of Judy tomorrow because that's to be witnessed.
Okay.
The word was witnessed by her.
This is just an extension as it was?
It's an extension of the exact wording, no changes to June 30th, 2017. It's just simply to give us a little breathing space to decide what we're going to do here. As I said originally, it was recorded in February. I believed it to be expiring in February of next year. It turned out it was voted on in December, 3 months prior to it being recorded. So we got a little quick time crunch here of not being able to really discuss it. So it's just confirms the original wording, the original rates, and gives us the June 30th to renew it.
Did the board vote last meeting for that? Have we had a vote?
No, we need a vote now.
Okay.
Motion to approve the extension of the town host agreement with TAM Inc. until June 30th, 2017.
Motion to extend the town tax agreement with TAM as it exists until June 30th, 2017.
Second.
Seconded by Art. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. That motion is approved 400 to extend the host town tax agreement with TAM as it exists until June 30th, 2017. Anything else garage related? FY18 budget. Anything new you want to tell us there, Dave?
No.
You didn't find an extra $20,000 to take care of that Bennington rescue thing?
That might be a little bit difficult to scrape out of this budget, I must say, but we'll...
Yeah, let's make the point with the voters that we have held the line on spending now for 3 years running, and a lot of the credit goes to Dave. He finds money in the couch cushions every single day that he squeezes out of this budget. And we've been doing a lot of stuff, making improvements to the parks. We're spending more on roads. We've got a sinking fund on equipment going. And we've been doing that for a while now without raising our expenses. So when somebody like, you know, when something like the Bennington Rescue Squad thing comes up, we're going to be hard-pressed to find $20,000 to cover new spending that way, unless by some magic, like we said before, the garage costs a lot less than we think.
The whole business is a real social question. I mean, this is, you understand what I'm trying to say, is that it's got to be coordination between the health insurance, the insurers, the hospital. They just can't dump it all on the taxpayers. I don't know.
It's a very difficult position, and you know, probably the biggest truth in the transport study was talking about is your simple question about someone getting a ride back to Filler, Fillmore Pond, or whatever.
That just makes people really irritated.
Yeah, and, but it's the structure they're dealing with, because if they do, and there's different levels of transport things, but you can bill each one out at different levels, but, you know, when you're running an emergency unit and then doing transports, he's right, if you start moving that thing at a different rate, all these federal regulators go, oh, well, then we can drop this down, and it is a spiral. That's why in a lot of areas you'll have transport ambulances, which are pretty much vans with a stretcher in it that they drive you back and forth, but I frankly don't see that much around here.
And they don't have to have all that $200,000 worth of extra equipment in there, do they?
A lot of them are pretty basic. At least where, you know, the ones that I know, they're fairly basic units. They're not decked out. They're certainly not paramedic units. And
That's something we ought to kind of ask them about. Does every ambulance have to be stocked to the hilt with all that stuff?
Well, we didn't ask them. That was a good sort of note.
If you're just using it to transport.
With five ambulances, you can have different levels.
Yes.
But you would need in that size at least three of them.
Paramedic.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. but still.
But yeah, I mean, there are
they're all the max.
That's what I'm saying.
I don't think there's anything that's just like a van.
Yeah.
Well, I think it would require what the operations chief was saying, and I forgot his name, Bill, I believe, was saying they'd have to look at not only just how many calls they get, but the nature of each of those calls and whether or not they can staff two ambulances in one van during that time, or if if they do that, are they going to run the risk that they get a call for somebody who actually needs their heart started and all they've got is the van? So it's not an easy question.
No, that's right. I understand.
And the big cost here, of course, is that the volunteerism has departed from
it's
almost
paid
everywhere, because people don't really have the ability to come out. Everyone has to be working, and you know, that is a big, big part of their budget. But
I was going to ask.
I mean, Arlington has paid people Monday through Friday. Manchester does.
I was wondering. I was going to ask him how much their payroll has increased over the last 5 years, and I didn't. I don't know if they.
But it was interesting that they have more EMTs than paramedics, who would be the higher pay rate. Clearly, the skill level is vastly different.
Which is higher?
Better than the paramedic. Because you have the EMT and the EMTP, and they don't have the EMTP here, EMTA, and then the paramedic. So it's...
paramedic's the high end of the...
Yeah, the paramedic's the high end of it.
Like a doctor on wheels, almost.
But, you know, but also I understand what they're up against. It's just like the ER. If you go with the ER, it's just the same...
Well, the hospital's in the same boat.
I know,
because
it's the same people day after day.
Yeah.
And if they get a readmittance after a discharge, it cuts out their Medicaid reimbursement. That's their, it's all, their whole Medicaid reimbursement is based on readmittance.
The call volume in Bellington is huge. Kind of stunning. But I'm sure it's a lot of the repetitive calls and things.
There may be an action in there for us too, if you know the number that he says, that
that's right,
our percentage of people who call absolutely call him and don't need to go to the hospital, is that people who want a warm place to stay, or is that people who have a different level of problem? That's something that we could maybe, I don't know how we'd figure that out, but it's something for us to think about too, is if we have people that are making a lot of calls, is that something we can deal with education, or do we really have a health problem we need to know about?
Yeah, that's going to be difficult.
Yeah.
Because I know, you know, I can imagine
HIPAA, you can't.
You know, and it's almost an untouchable in the 911 world. If someone calls, you respond.
I realize that.
Yeah, and we all did many where you go and they wanted to have a talk for a little while, and it's like, you know, we really have to leave, you know.
Right.
And some people do just want to ride down to the hospital.
You know? Yeah.
So yeah, it's always a tough call.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Other budget stuff you want to Tell us about.
Basically, the budget is because we are talking about changing the pay structure for the town clerk.
It's a wash.
The budget actually goes up 1% as we transfer $21,000 in to improve that pay. But the revenues that we now, that we town doesn't see, Judy takes directly, we're putting in revenue. So it's a 1% increase in revenue, so it's just a wash. The line is a little higher, but it's the same
money, right,
just being filtered correctly. The one thing that we had talked about at the budget meeting that we need to resolve is health benefits. We had talked about whether or not we were going to, what type of health benefits we were going to offer, because we are going to have a new employee, the sixth public works worker, in the next couple of weeks, and by January 2nd, I would need to know what we intend to offer. I've made an inquiry to VLCT. They basically said that if I join their health program, that they would be glad to have Hickok and Boardman provide me an answer. But the cost of that would be probably more than just giving them full health benefits. So I sent our personnel policy to Merrill at Wilmington's office, just say, this is what we say. It says we have the right to change whatever we want, but when you get into healthcare, it always gets a little dicey. Where do we fall if we tell our new employee that's individual only? Where do we fall if we tell his family? And then for that matter, we have the town clerk. The town clerk, we have a specific policy that prohibits elected officials from getting health care. It was passed somewhere back in the 90s.
Is this Shaftsbury?
Shaftsbury.
Okay.
Judy was specifically exempted from it because she already had health care and she had been here for a very long time. So that's all fine. Because I was curious about some reasons there, but it's very specifically that elected officials are not entitled to health care. It has been given to the clerks for as long as Judy's been here, 35 years. But it's just there. The policy as it stands says no, there's no health care for an elected official. And she is the only elected official that has health care. Currently, the town clerk's hours would have to increase to make it eligible under other laws, because you have to be here for 35 hours a week, which would be an increase without any increased compensation or anything to get the health benefits, which alone, again, depending on what the board decides, individual, two-person or family, can be, $6,000 to $16,000. It's a huge, it's a big amount of money. There's no doubt about it.
And
it's
the
almost the money to pay for Bennington ambulance.
Well, I get. I'll make a motion so that we aren't just talking about this all night long.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I guess I would like to. The first motion is that we offer just the single person, or just give health insurance for the person only for the sixth public employee.
Okay.
We'll take them one at a time.
Okay.
I'll second. Go ahead.
Yeah. Discussion
next. I second for discussion purposes, but my first thought is I don't know that we can, I'm not sure the right path is to single out this new employee for something different than what the rest of the crew is getting. And the rest of the crew has been offered family plans.
Yes, that is it. We do, and that was the point of because I believe, Ken, you brought it up, you had heard that, someone who had been hired and discovered that they weren't getting the same benefits as other people. There is no doubt an inequity here. There's no way around it. There's an inequity between people who are taking individual plans compared to those who are taking family plans. This structure exists. It's here. This is, in both categories, this is the make or break point. We have a new person coming on because we downsized the crew with the water department leaving. We're bringing it back up. So this is the decision point. The personnel policy clearly states that we have the right to change this stuff. So here's a new employee, here's the time to change it. Legally, I've made inquiries based on Ken's concern, and I believe, Art, you've heard something too along those lines. I'm still waiting for a reply because I would like to be sure that we're not going to walk into a trap, because that happens in these things too. I would think we're on pretty solid ground in changing what we're offering new employees.
That's all I'm doing.
It's just for the new employee, and this is the offer, this is the job. It's this pay, you're getting health insurance. Many places only offer individual plans now. I would like to offer everybody family plans, but you know, it's a new world. So
we could still offer that they can buy up.
Absolutely.
Use their own money to buy a family.
I think that's kind of a given in the in the programs. And they might even be better off going out to the marketplace for the rest of the family. But rather than the town getting embroiled in that, we can always offer the individual, and you can always go to our current provider, Blue Cross Blue Shield, and say, well, what can we work out with the family? And if Blue Cross sends us something saying, well, your employee wants to upgrade to this, this is your portion for this year, and they're paying the rest, fine, as long as we pay the individual portion. Well, however the medical market works, that would be fine with
us. Well, I mean, they would be buying into our group policy. We wouldn't be sending them out to buy an individual policy for the rest of the family.
Well, I don't know. I'd have to see how that works, because if we're opening it up to... I don't know if it can be done. I don't know if you can expand the policy you have from us without causing... it's a question I'll have to ask Blue Cross Blue Shield or the Health Connect people, and just say, what would be the best way? Because this goes on all over. I just don't know the answer. I mean, plenty of people are out there with individual programs, yet they're insuring other people in their family, whether they piggyback them on or... I mean, I'm sure it's a pretty standard thing. But like I said, I just don't know what the answer is.
Well, just the humane answer I think, is that we let them, that they should be able to buy into our group plan, because if you go out, you know, as one guy buying insurance, it's incredibly expensive. And what about the idea that you had offered before, that you offer a compensation package that is this big, and the employee can decide how much of that is health care and how much is salary?
I think you'd have to do that to everybody. I think that's a discussion for a different time.
I hear what you're saying, and I agree. The constraints we have now and needing to wrap this up in 5 weeks, that's a mammoth discussion. Because there's lots of implications. There's a huge change for certain employees who like I say, there's inequities here. Where if you try and level the field, people are going to lose benefits. So that's a much bigger topic. I don't think we could resolve that in a few weeks here. And we're already paying the new rates anyway, so, because we already paid January's Blue Cross bill.
Any more discussion?
I would just like to start it with this new employee. That way, if we do decide... The other thing, too, is we could always consider as with a pay raise, too. I mean, that type of thing. But for right now, let's start in with, with that, okay?
Well, it might come out, Dave, that if they said, well, you're discriminating because you're giving one guy a family plan and paying for it, and then the other ones are just single, that they might say, well, you got to give everybody the single plan and let the family people pay the extra.
Whatever direction it says. I think at this point, as far as the board goes, that it's single for the new employee, everything else remains the same. And if I get legal advice or Blue Cross tells me, you know, I'm crazy, you can't do it, then we'll take it from there. But I think
we would have problems. We could have problems within an existing organization if that discrimination was found. But I think Art's right. For a new employee, we can decide how much we're going to pay him based on experience and everything else. And we're going to decide right now, we're going to pay him X amount of salary and single pay, single health care. Anything else? Any more discussion? All in favor of the motion to offer the new Public Works employee single health care coverage only, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstaining? 400.
Now my next motion is that the new town clerk not get health insurance. I think you're opening up a whole can of worms being a public employee, publicly elected person. That would allow all of us and everybody else to say we need it. So,
all right, the motion is to not provide health insurance to the town clerk after March 1st.
Let's not say March 1st. Our term doesn't end until, I don't know the exact date.
April 1st, and the last day of March, I think.
Yeah, it would be paid through until April 1st.
To a new.
Why don't we just say the new town clerk?
To the newly elected town clerk on March 6th, 2017. Is there a second?
Second.
My only hesitation on this one is that the town clerk is the is really our only elected official who's who's really close to a full-time employee. We need somebody in here 30 hours a week. Sounds like if we're going to give them health care, they've got to work 35 hours a week.
35.
But in this day and age, finding somebody who will work for 30 hours a week without health care benefits when you can only get them through your employer is going to cut into the pool of people that want to do that job.
I tend to agree. It's not much of an incentive to get a 30-hour job and have to go out on a public.
What's the salary going to be, roughly?
The salary would be $28,000. That's basically what it is now.
$14
Which, of course,
an
would be more dollars an hour by shortening the week. Many clerk's offices are not open on Fridays.
There's work for enough for her to do for 35 hours, right? Or no?
The current clerk does not work 35 hours a week.
She works
12, what is it? 32.
Yeah. Pretty close.
Isn't 32 full time now?
No.
Has to be 35 to be full time.
It's 24. They'd still get the pension because it's 24 under some quirk in the law that the. If you're here for over 24 hours, you have to be enrolled in Beamers, which is why a lot of the clerks do the direct contribution because you can be voted out.
Yes, yeah, so I'm a little concerned that it lowers the level of interest in the position, but who knows?
Yeah, it's hard because if you have someone who arranges the hours well. Because the office closes at 3 o'clock every day, except for Mondays. Where it closes at 4:30. You could actually be taking your kid to school, dropping him off, coming to work, and leaving and picking your kid up from school. And at $28,000 a year plus a pension plan. I'm hearing this too. I know it's taking away a big benefit to it. But then we have to go back to, is it just going to be individual, which then it's not so big a benefit. Mm-hmm. Not saying that health care isn't a big benefit, but it's a tough call. But I have to point out, because as I was looking into health care, I came across this, that it is a policy that elected officials don't have. So we'd have to amend the policy to allow elected or a targeted specific elected official.
Is that personnel policy?
No, it's a policy. It's a board policy. It passed.
Select board policy.
I thought I'd put it in the Dropbox. I'll get it in the Dropbox.
Yeah, I did not know about that one.
Yeah, I didn't either. But I came across it. I'm looking at this because in ongoing discussions and looking into how it turned out that we have one elected official on health care, it's clear from the wording and the timing of it. I think it was 1997 or something that it was meant to cover Judy because she had had it, so it was specific to that, and which, you know, for someone who's at that point had already been working a long time.
We paid your deductible too? We have a...
Yeah, also. Yeah, so that's $4,000 on top of that, the deductible account. So, yeah, I mean, you have to take that into account,
agree
too,
to pay the deductible or something.
And thank you for bringing that up, because I in your motion for the new public works worker, I would have taken to include the health care account, the $4,000 we give everybody else for the deductibles. Mm-hmm. And I kind of saw, I'm glad you brought that up, because I regard that as one, but it's two separate benefits, actually. Yeah. And that's a pretty big one, too.
That's a
getting your deductibles paid is pretty big, too. It doesn't have to be decided right now. It can be decided, you know, preferably by the first meeting in January, so that people who are putting in petitions know exactly what we're doing. We haven't finalized the budget, but it's pretty open. Judy gets an $8,000 stipend now. The average fees collected were $20,000 over 3 years, so we're talking about $28,000 for to entice someone to run for the position, plus the pension benefits.
The only thing is we got a motion. We got to handle that one way or the other. So.
Any more discussion on the motion? All in favor of the motion that the town clerk will, the newly elected town clerk on March 6, 2017, will not get health benefits from the town. Say aye.
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 Opposed?
Aye.
So the vote splits 2-2, so the motion is not agreed to.
I think it needs further discussion.
That's probably the best way.
And it needs another board member here too. Yeah.
If we don't pay the premium, then maybe give them the deductible portion or something. But that's two different things.
Well, then we're getting into. It's not easy. If that didn't hit the drop box, I'll get it to you so you can see when this was passed. Mm-hmm. And.
I mean, did we really need a motion if it's been passed and that's a policy? Well, policy, we can override the policy.
We can override policy, yeah.
Yeah, because actually, whether you're correct, Mitch, without doing anything,
just let it go.
Come when she gets elected or he or she gets elected to the post, there's no health benefits. Mm-hmm. So that's what the policy is.
That's right, actually.
That's a
good point. Unless we override it.
That's what our policy would direct us to do. We can always say, we have reasons that we want to override policy, but we need to have good reasons to override policy.
Yeah, I want to make sure that this was out on the table because I was not aware that this was an actual thing. So, but that's correct. If there's no action, then there's no health care.
Well, unless we decide we want to.
Unless you override it.
Unless we override it, yeah. Okay. These health care ones are tough.
Oh, goodness.
Yeah, especially when you have what we have a mixed bag here, and but you do have to address it as each new person comes on.
I want to have 30 employees. huge number.
It is. It's probably the biggest problem out there is how to handle this.
All right. So, action item on that. Keep thinking about it. Mm-hmm. Other business?
Oh, I have none.
Okay. I had an action from a couple of weeks ago that I didn't get around to until just today. We have the Shire's housing has a plan to construct a housing development in Perrin Acres, and we have a letter and some drawings on that they're asking for our input on. I just got those into the Dropbox this afternoon, so we should look at those.
And how many units was that? There was like 22 units or something?
Bring that up. So this is from Stephanie Lane. As executive director of Shires, I'm writing to inform you of a proposed project for which Shires is actively seeking to secure funding. I'm requesting your confirmation that our project
is consistent with the town of Shaftsbury's planning goals, and I'm asking for your support. Your comments are welcome and appreciated. Our funding application requires your comments, if any, to be incorporated, and as such, I'm asking that they be offered in writing, addressed to my attention, which we will provide to the funders. Shires Housing is planning its Parent Acre Village project, which involves the new construction of 4 multifamily buildings on properties located in the town of Shaftsbury. Lake Parent Village is a rural cluster development for low to moderate income families in an area that has limited housing. Although the project site is located just over the town of Shaftsbury line, the site is within walking distance of the village of North Bennington. The project will be located adjacent to a land conservation district bordering Lake Parent. In total, the Lake Parent Village rental units comprise approximately 22,000 square feet of residential space. Shire's goals for this project are proposed site plans that are based on smart growth principles of compact development and are designed as distinctive, attractive neighborhood with a strong sense of place. The site will have a common central green space in the center of the development, open front porches, walkways, and preservation of natural and man-made features. The site design is reflective and appropriate for the surrounding rural community in which the project is proposed. The site design will encourage recreation and develop a sense of community with the 4 buildings oriented around an open space. Parking will be separate on the site and will be in close proximity to each building to avoid large parking areas to tie to the rural nature of the area. The apartments will be clustered in no more than 8 units per acre with a development density appropriate for their rural location. All Lake Parent Village buildings will be constructed to meet or exceed energy code. The dwelling units will be designed for compliance in codes and regulations, as well as provide bathrooms, kitchens, and interior finishes that meet standards and are attractive to potential tenants. The project will be affordable in perpetuity and serve mixed income households. Of the proposed units, 50% will be affordable to households making 50% or less of median income. 36 will be affordable to households with 60% of median income, and the remaining 14% affordable to households without income restrictions. We look forward to bringing an investment into the town of Shaftsbury and Bennington County that allows us to construct these properties, maintain their affordability, and enable them to be operationally efficient and physically well-maintained for a minimum of 20 years. Please let me know if you have any questions. I look forward to working with you as we move forward on this project.
And just to give you some numbers for Mitch, there are 22 total units. There are 4 one-bedrooms, 8 two-bedrooms, 8 three-bedrooms, and 2 four-bedroom units. We'll have 45 parking spaces and covers an area of about 2.5 acres. The building area is 21,750 square feet.
Yeah, so here it is, and it's a... It's a fairly large area, as they said, designed around green space and common area with separate parking.
Is there a house there now?
No, I think that's like a 7-acre open lot right there. Mm-hmm.
Is it? I couldn't picture it.
McCarthy Acres?
Yeah.
That's so they walked right on the end of that road.
I thought so. You go past Jerry Owl's place.
Yeah.
And then... I think there's
a house. It was a house there, but I hadn't been down in any years.
Is that Billy? I think there's a shack and some things there that are probably going to come down. Okay. Town line is back this way someplace.
Town line is down below you here.
Down here somewhere?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. Yeah, they said it was just over the town line.
Yeah.
I mean, walkable to the village of North Bennington.
How many units stay with more than 2 bedrooms?
With more than 2 bedrooms, there were 18.
18.
Oh, more than 2 bedrooms, I'm sorry. There were 10 with more than 2 bedrooms.
And 12 with 2 and under.
Yes.
Here are the numbers here. It's 2.
Yeah, in the box in the corner.
Oh, this is total down here. Okay, gotcha. 18, yeah.
Is this the same organization that rebuilt a couple of the brick houses for over $1 million?
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just the money they spend is just unbelievable.
Yeah, but they're spending it in Shaftsbury.
Yeah,
I don't understand your objection to it. I mean,
that's what we want.
It's my taxpayers' money, my God.
Well, my concern is that's low-income housing, a lot of it.
50% is low-income, and the other 50% is not.
How many kids are you bringing into school?
Depends on how many people are renting them.
Is this gone before the zoning board or the DRB?
I don't think they're to that point yet. I believe they're at the seeking funding part, according to the letter. So they're looking for our support that says, yeah, we want this, and they're seeking funding. I mean, it's not all your tax dollars at work here. I mean, they seek funding from all kinds of places to do this.
I think it's a great idea.
Why would we not want somebody to spend what?
Everyone's complaining there's not affordable housing. There's no affordable housing in town or anywhere else.
We have a lot of low income people who could use low income housing.
My concern is if you bring in, I don't know, throw you a number, 50 kids.
Well, here's another problem. Is that District 1?
That's a good question. I believe it is.
Yes.
And it also, because this is very early, Ken, to address your points, I mean, I don't know what they would need to get permits to build this, although they get a lot of leeway for this type of housing. I don't think it's an automatic. Questions like that come up in normal DRB hearings. What impact will there be on school, fire protection, all that stuff? It does get looked into or addressed as the proceedings go along. This is very, as Tim said, this is very early. This is still securing funding sources for this.
I think that's District 1.
I believe it is. I mean, you're right down there in North Bennington.
Yeah. Well, they're just looking for our blessing.
That was that lot right there. We had to go down there when they were for a DRB thing. I can't remember. But yeah, I think that's just like part of a 7-acre parcel right on that corner.
Yeah, it is. It's a fairly big parcel.
Yeah. That's
left.
As a matter of fact.
Is that the full?
More toward
the
Yeah.
Exactly. This side of the property.
There was a house.
But
I hadn't been down that road.
Yeah, that is it. Okay.
The next road would be Lake
Perrinville. Yes.
Well. Do you think we can be ready to decide this one on June 2 as well?
Yeah.
I mean January 2?
Jeez, the grand list would increase.
Yeah, I mean it's...
Well, it would.
If it wasn't for Shire's housing, nobody would be building anything in Shaftsbury these days.
You're going to attach your tent on them.
All right.
Are they the same people running into trouble in Bennington?
They're all over Bennington.
Yeah, Shire's housing running into problems with Silver Street?
Yep, that's your same outlet.
Yep. Bennington said, not in our backyard.
Yep.
When they do that with
I think Shaftsbury should say, in our backyard.
Yeah.
We need it. We've got people that can use it.
Well, so Silver Street, what happened with that? Is that where they want to put a garden in while they're waiting for it? No.
Where's that? I'm sorry.
What was the Silver Street?
Oh, the local people have got hired lawyers and all that sort of stuff to stop it.
Mm-hmm. Hmm.
That's such an
angle. I think it's
good. Yeah, well, I need to drive down that road again and see what's exactly there.
It is.
So, yeah, let's take that under advisement.
Yep.
Okay. If there's no other business action items, reviewing from December 5th, the request from Shire's Housing, we're looking at that now. Ken, where are you with the bylaws question and the gravel pits? Because you were going to look into that some more.
I can get down to Brian Lett, and he hasn't got back to me yet.
All right. Are you on board with us with the rest of the bylaws changes?
Yeah, I would say
okay.
Yes.
Good. And then we had an item from the 5th to vote on the host town tax extension, which we did.
Yep.
I noted that we need an action to get our community appropriations process on the website so people can access that. The garage committee is going to come up with a way to save us a couple $100,000 on that site plan, we all hope. We need to decide what we want to do about health care for the town clerk, and then we need to come back on January 2nd and make a decision on the Shire's Parent Acre project. That one, I would say that we don't have to make a decision then. If we start hearing a lot of public input on that, maybe we have a hearing or something on that, but we'll put the word out and see what people say.
That's a good idea.
If there's nothing else, is there a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
From Mitch?
Second.
Seconded by Art. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
We stand adjourned. 8:46.